This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised. Hey guys, Sean Fay-Wolfe of Diamond Axe Studios here, and welcome to part 2 of my video counting down the top 10 worst hit songs of 2021. If you haven't seen it yet, make sure you check out part 1 of this video using the link in the description below so you know what numbers 10, 9, 8, 7, and 6 are before you watch this. If you've already seen part 1, then great, we'll be getting back to the countdown in just a minute, but before we do that, I have a very special announcement to make.
What you know about Radiohead's hit song Creep? When you do that jump, you can feel the natural breeze.
I'm sure that all of you remember this song from the ending of part 1, a parody of Astronaut in the Ocean written by a whole bunch of my friends and colleagues and then recorded by yours truly as a cover to play over the end credits. You probably figured that I recorded that song just as a wacky joke to end the video on, and yes, that is why I did it. But what you probably didn't guess is that this particular joke is now officially on sale.
I believe in B.O.B. Don't believe in GL.
That's right, you can now buy the Astronaut in the Ocean parody on iTunes, Amazon Music, or a whole bunch of other services using the link in the description. And not only am I going to donate 100% of the profits from the song to TEAMSEAS, but for every dollar the song makes, I'm going to match it with $2 of my own money. If you don't know, TEAMSEAS is a movement started by Mark Rober and Mr. Beast this past October in partnership with the real-life astronauts in the ocean at the Ocean Conservancy. For every $1 donated to TEAMSEAS, they're going to remove 1 pound of trash from the ocean through beach cleanup crews and the installation of automated refuse capture devices. That means that if you spend $1 to buy this song, you're going to be removing 3 pounds of trash from the ocean. I don't need to tell you how important ocean conservation is. We truly can't take for granted what an incredible place our Earth is. And I figured that something like this is the absolute least I could do to help make this crazy blue sphere we poop on just a little bit better. You can watch Mark and Jimmy's video about the TEAMSEAS campaign using the link in the description below if you have any questions, and you can donate directly to them if you prefer. But if you'd like to get the most bang for your buck while legally owning my angelically beautiful singing voice in the process, then please consider purchasing Cucumber Melon Lotion, an Astronaut in the Ocean parody by Diamond Axe Studios Music, available now on these online music retail services. Thank you, and now on with the show.
But I've been places, so I'm okay-ish, so I'm okay.
Yeah, I'm okay, bitch!
You know, sometimes I have to listen to a song over and over again for months on end before I decide to put it on this list. Sometimes I just have to look at the title.
And I know it's not a race, but it looks like you're getting over me faster than I'm getting over you.
Have I mentioned yet that this was a bad year for country music?
I'm sick of sitting at the house, dying on my phone, wishing I was somewhere I can be alone.
Well, I can't say I had a cross between insufferable Sam Hunt flatulation and an insufferable BuzzFeed article on my 2021 bingo card. It truly is a magical time to be alive.
I've been breaking up was easy in the 90s.
A lot of people act like bro country is a problem that's pretty much been dealt with by this point, and it's certainly true that Nashville is no longer the domain of the meat-headed dude bros singing about leggy, daisy-duked country girls making their corn stalks grow while using hip-hop slang so awkward and outdated it makes the rappin' for Jesus guy look like the notorious Big himself. But the thing you have to understand about country artists is that once they get big, they literally never go away. The tides of Nashville may have shifted, but that doesn't mean that we got rid of all the bro country guys. All it meant is that the dudes who got famous making Donkey, Country Girl Shake It For Me, and Corn Star are now being forced by their labels to make genuine statements of love and emotional sincerity. And for the most part, that's gone about as well as you'd think it would.
Howdy there, my name is Pig Swill McCoy. You may recognize me from my smash hit country song, Florida Man and the Truck Nuts of Justice. But recently, at the request of my label, I've decided to change up my sound a little bit, and so tonight, I'm gonna be playing y'all something very special from right down here in the heart of Dixie. Let's do it. I can't decide which I love more, Jesus or my tractor.
I hope you look just like your mama.
Okay, I am exaggerating a bit. Most of the bro country sellouts in practice have been around 30% douchey and 70% boring. Most of them really aren't that bad. But Sam Hunt absolutely is that bad.
Funny how you haven't changed a bit, but you're twice as pretty.
This guy has been a thorn in my side for years now. He's one of the most punchable artists alive, with one of the douchiest voices I've ever heard and a slimy, self-satisfied attitude to match. He was actually one of the few bro country artists who actually tried to tap into more serious, emotionally affecting subject matter before it was cool, and the result was one of the worst songs of the entire 2010s, where he speaks saying it to a girl for 4 minutes about how sorry he is that drunk creeps wouldn't stop hitting on her at the bar, while giving every indication that the only reason he hasn't joined them is because he's not drunk yet.
And I know it starts with hello, and the next thing you know, you try to be nice, and some guy's getting too close, trying to pick you up. Could've walked away, but you're still here, and I'm still here. Come on, let's see where it goes.
I mean, I guess in the sense that I should be grateful that Sam Hunt has apparently given up trying to say anything meaningful and instead reached for the low-hanging fruit of people nostalgic for wrapping phone lines around their fingers. Still hasn't given up the speak singing, though.
Bartender looks at me like, pony up, man, we're closing down. Paid the tab, I turned around.
So I hear you asking, what exactly is the premise of Breaking Up Was Easy in the 90s by Sam Hunt? Well, basically, this dude has got no self-control to stop himself from creeping on his ex's Facebook and seeing what a great life she's living with her new man, and he wishes he could go back to the 90s, not just because he wouldn't be able to see that, but also so that he could convince himself that maybe she did want him after all.
Back then, I could have convinced myself that maybe you called when I was out. You didn't know what to say, so you didn't leave a message.
So, yeah, this is basically an entire song from the point of view of this guy.
Anyway, I'll just leave a quick message, because you might be trying to call me right now, and I don't want to tie up the line, so I guess, give me a call.
Girl, you're everywhere, everywhere but behind me.
This song is just an obnoxious jackass being weird and mopey, bolstered by one of the most embarrassing premises for a hook I've ever heard in my life. A lot of people gave shit to Sam Hunt last year over Hard to Forget, a song where he keeps running into his ex all over town and asks if that means she's still into him when she's clearly not. But Hard to Forget was an upbeat, almost jaunty joke of a song where Sam was clearly just teasing the girl while also laughing at himself for having such a hard time letting go. I mean, any song that has this in it, no, Sam knew how absurd this whole thing was, or at least someone on his production team did, whereas Breaking Up has no bounce to it. It's just downcast and tedious, making you feel like a loser when you listen to the verses before making you feel like an idiot when you hear him say the title line. If you put the performance and the title line aside, this song is basically just I Should Probably Go to Bed Again. I would say that it's amazing that the American people mass-bought two songs in 1 year about the objectively pathetic misery pit that is being so torn up over an ex that you can't rip your eyes away from their socials, except that nobody actually bought either of those songs. They're both only here because of, you guessed it, the radio. Nobody wanted them, nobody actively sought them out, and yet, for the millions of Americans out in the boonies without high-speed internet, it's either this or nothing. Nice job, greatest country on earth.
Okay, bye. Hey, me again. Thought I might have heard a voice when I was hanging up. Nope. Guess not. Okay, I will talk to you soon. Hello? Nope, sorry.
In fact is, I need help, I'm failing all my classes. They think that I need glasses.
Hey guys, guess what? I like Lil Baby now.
Brand new whip, got no key. Tell my clone, no start.
2018 was one of the worst years in recent memory for general pop culture, music very much included, and considering that mumbling trap songs happened to hit their peak during that awful, awful year, the internet collectively decided that mumbling trap songs were the worst thing ever to happen to music, with Lil Baby as the poster child for why. Oh, and don't get mad at me for calling 2018 Lil Baby a mumble rapper. He was slurring his lines so hard back then that he literally made a greedy Jew joke on his biggest hit and no one even noticed. But yeah, I thought he was a talentless, over-Xanaxed hack back then, especially considering that he was one of the only trap mumblers who was still huge by the time 2019 came around. And I continued hating Lil Baby well into 2020, until suddenly I didn't anymore.
But the way that we living is not getting better, you gotta know how to survive.
I do realize how very ridiculously, almost comically stereotypical it is that I, as a white music critic, didn't take the mumble rapper seriously until he made a rousing Black Lives Matter anthem. But you know what? I'm not afraid to acknowledge my mistakes. I was closed-minded back then. But after being blown away by the bigger picture, I gave his his most recent album, My Turn, Another Chance, and in the end, I wound up enjoying pretty much everything he put out in 2020. Not only did I find that Lil Baby is definitely capable of making really hard-hitting, compelling music about the struggles he's overcome, but even his less heavy songs still work really well as enjoyable hip-hop bangers. I'm still not particularly a fan of his earlier stuff I've heard, but he's really come into his sound with time, and I'm looking forward to see what he does next. I can now confidently say that Lil Baby is an artist that I like. So I guess it just goes to show that even artists I like can still make really, really shitty music sometimes.
I'm like, come and put that pussy on me, don't be running from me. If I like it, I spend money on it, get whatever from me.
I took a pretty instant dislike to On Me from the first moment I heard it, and given my history with Lil Baby, I came back to it constantly throughout 2021, figuring I must just be missing something, listening to it from every angle to see if there was anything worth latching onto, anything enjoyable about this at all, but no. I'm sorry, this just sucks, man. As much as I hate to say it, this one just got worse and worse with every listen. And the more I looked into its background, the more I understood why. Some of you may remember that a couple years ago, I called Lil Baby the Adam Sandler of hip-hop. Now, that was mostly a joke made in service of calling Gunna the Rob Schneider of hip-hop, an assessment I stand by 100%, by the way. But the more I think about it, the more sense the Lil Baby Adam Sandler comparison makes. Because Adam Sandler is an extremely talented actor.
A bad person, you have no right taking people's confidence in your service. You understand me, sir?
Yeah. I bet that's something a lot of you weren't aware of. All throughout his acting career, from the mid-90s right up to the present day, Adam Sandler has received a pretty consistent stream of critical acclaim, being praised as an incredibly charming and likable screen presence with the capacity for a wide range of acting ability, including thrillers, romance, voice work, comedy, and gripping dramatic intensity. And yet, I'm willing to bet that the majority of you didn't know that. Because when you hear the name Adam Sandler, what immediately jumps into your mind?
What are you doing?
Why can't I just lay with you? You're a weirdo!
Yeah. Exactly. Adam Sandler might have the capacity to do amazing things, but he's proven so many times that he's so willing to give so little of a shit and pander to such a lowest common denominator that it's practically become a human instinct to cringe every time you hear the words Adam Sandler movie. And look, Happy Madison films are very profitable. There is an audience who will throw money at them every time, and they require substantially less effort on Sandler's part than in Uncut Gems or A Punch Drunk Love. But by this point, Adam has proven quite definitively that he is not the kind of actor who can phone it in over and over without trashing his reputation in the process. And I'm not gonna say that On Me is Lil Baby's Jack and Jill, but I do think it may very well be his water boy.
Why she talking crazy about me like I don't do more than my part?
On Me is a lazy song that Lil Baby put very little effort into and just threw together without caring about it. That's not me projecting, and that's not me throwing baseless insults. Lil Baby is open about it. I had an amazing year, but I didn't have anything else planned, so I just threw this together because I was bored in lockdown and had nothing better to do. It's just something to stick out there. Yeah, we can tell.
Never gonna get caught up about it, know how the game go. Tennis chain busting look like rainbows.
On Me sounds like an unfinished freestyle that never should have seen the light of day. It's only 2 minutes long, but it feels like double that. Lil Baby just wraps around in circles with no variation in his flow, delivery, or the beat under him. There's not one single moment of interest, lyrical or otherwise, in the entire song. It's all just overdone flexing that drags on forever, stuck in this turgid middle ground that absolutely refuses to move. And Lil Baby, stuck without a topic to emotionally cling to or a hook to build on, gives his most empty, joyless, ugly vocal performance in years.
I told Brody and them to park the car, but they still wrecked. I don't think nobody around still, but I still check.
On Me is a very bad song that I can't stand listening to, but more than that, it's a perfect representation of everything that worries me about Lil Baby's future as an artist. I know that the man is capable of great things, but he throws out so many half-assed verses all over the place and all of them manage to chart. Lil Baby has found his Happy Madison audience. He knows there are people who will throw money at him no matter how much he phones it in. I mean, for God's sake, even this music video is just cut up footage from a random vacation he took that opens with a joke about how they didn't bother to film a real music video because no one cared. He knows that he can get away with phoning it in, and that scares me. Lil Baby clearly wants to be the next Drake, a kingmaker who can put his name on literally anything and it'll move, but Drake managed to do that by hitting a perfect sweet spot of cross-demographic mass appeal, and Lil Baby is far too distinctive a presence to be anywhere near that malleable. And look, there are absolutely some artists who have the charisma and appeal to immediately improve any piece of shit project they're attached to. Lil Baby is not that kind of artist. He's not a bad rapper, but he's not good enough to get away with not trying. And I hope he starts seriously considering his prospects for longevity before the world gets really sick of him.
If I like it, I spend money on it, get whatever from it.
I just
part one, I talked about how much more enjoyable it was to make the worst list this year as opposed to last year, because I actually had a decent-sized pile of shit to shovel through. But there's another big difference that has made this easily my favorite year to talk about bad music so far. I started making worst lists at the end of every year back in 2017, and literally every single time I've made one since then, the top few spots on the list have been occupied by songs that bug me for reasons that go beyond the music itself. For the last few years, whenever I really looked deep inside myself to figure out what music truly bothered me the most, my picks for the worst songs of the year have always required me to do a whole bunch of tedious moralizing to get my point across as to why I feel that way. Now, to be fair, I stand by those picks. They were my legitimate opinions that I felt the need to explain as best I could, and I hope I was able to discuss them in a way that was interesting and engaging for you guys. But I am saying that talking about them was definitely not fun for me, nor do I imagine it was much fun for you either. The point I'm getting at is that it's really refreshing that literally every single song on this list only made it on here because it's horribly obnoxious and sounds like shit.
We just trying to catch a good time, even if it takes all night.
This was a bad year for country music.
Yeah, we picking on them guitars just right. Everybody singing Dixieland delight.
As we now enter discussion of the fourth country song on this list, I'm afraid that I'm giving you guys the idea that I'm somehow against country music on whole. I mean, I get the assumption. I'm not a country boy. I've definitely spent a good portion of my life outdoors and in the woods, but I'm still from a New England suburb within driving distance of Boston and New York, and I'm definitely not above, making up a farcical Bible Belt caricature and naming him Pigswill McCoy. So I'd just like to take a second to clarify that I do, in fact, enjoy country music. I Hope You're Happy Now by Carly Pearson Lee Brice was my third favorite hit song of last year, and Marry Me by Thomas Rhett was my pick for the single best hit song of 2018. I'm more than capable of appreciating a good country song when I hear it, but I'm sorry, Morgan Wallen yelling the N-word must have been one block from the Jenga Tower too many. Because ever since then, country music has been in fucking sufferable. I can't even blame the listening public for this, because just like all the other country songs I've talked about on this list so far, it was the radio that forced this song into being a thing, even though the sales and streaming numbers made it pretty fucking clear that no one actually liked it. But okay, let's take a step back for a second. It is extremely tempting for me to just charge in guns blazing and rip this piece of hack garbage apart, but instead, let me prove to you that I'm not a mindless country hater by going into a bit more detail.
Way down here we all got that southern drive. Take our time when we talk, hey y'all.
I mean, why is this so insufferable, Sean? It's just a song about a dude laying back, relaxing, and enjoying a warm summer night. What's so terrible about that? Is it just because of the shitty swamped out bass, the shitty vocal processing, and the shitty out of place trap production? I mean, yeah, all of those things are awful, but believe it or not, that's actually not an automatic deal breaker for me. I mean, take a look at this.
Take me to the country, show me where you're from. I said, Shawty, you gon' love me.
Yeah, in case you missed it, Florida Georgia Line made another song with Nelly this year, and pretty much everyone absolutely toured a new one, but honestly, I was fine with it, and that's in spite of the fact that the production and mixing wasn't any less oafish and poor on it, and it was significantly more embarrassing.
Got the coupe on a new town road.
Ugh. Woof. But yeah, I was still okay with this, because even in spite of the incompetent mixing and clumsy hip-hop elements, it still moved, it had energy, it was exciting. It's the same reason I've never hated That's My Kind of Night or a whole bunch of other bro country songs that everyone told me to hate. My guilty pleasure list can accommodate for quite a bit of cringe if a song kicks right. Good Time has all the same awkward, poorly made bro country trappings as a little bit, but it just sits there and lets them all pile up on top of each other. Like, what the hell are trap snares and cheap 808s doing on this laid-back campfire song? When I said before that bro country never really died, this is what I'm referring to. The artists may be following different instructions, but they're using the same tools, and these are not the tools for this job. Oh, and speaking of the artist.
Yeah, don't take much for us to have it all.
That's right. Yeah, that's the other big bro country cliche that got carried over. The smugness. The lyrics may be saying, we're chilling here, come join us, but the tone and delivery are saying something very different. The worst bro country is always so smarmy and self-impressed, just through the way their voices are inflected. It's like a Pauly Shore performance in musical form, and it's all over Good Time. This isn't Otis Redding sitting on the dock of the bay after a long day of work. It's Bruno Mars jerking off in a Snuggie, saying he might mess around and get a college degree if he feels like humoring his dad. There's no warm warmth, no relief, no positivity that goes beyond condescending lip service. It's just a guy with no problems sitting around reveling in his own hedonism, thinking he's got the entire world figured out and wondering why you're not on his level yet. So yeah, I think I've made my point. If you want a good country song with this topic from 2021, go listen to Happy Does, because even now, 31 years into his career and decades past his prime, I'd still rather listen to Kenny Chesney any day over the third best member of Zac Brown's EDM trio.
Good time.
Oh, I think I got a bite.
That's what the mask is. That's what the point of the mask is.
Yeah, we fancy like Applebee's on a date night. Got that bourbon street steak with the Oreo shake.
These year-end worst lists always end up getting more views than any of my other videos, so I assume a fair number of you don't really follow the charts outside of these end-of-the-year reflections. So for those of you who are new here, let me answer your first question right away. No, this is not a jingle made for an Applebee's commercial that somehow became an ironic meme. It's an actual major label release that hit number 3 on the Hot 100 and is now one of the biggest smash hit country crossovers in years. Now, based on all the other country songs we've talked about so far, you're probably thinking, wow, country radio has really hit a new all-time low. I mean, how on earth could those clueless redneck DJs possibly think anyone could enjoy this? And you're right, this song did get a ton of airplay on the radio. Months after it had already become a top 10 hit.
My girl is banging, she's so low maintenance.
Yeah, you heard me right. Out of all the absolutely god-awful country music spewed out by 2021, Fancy Like, the fucking Applebee's song, is the one that actually got big organically, slowly rising up the streaming and sales charts fueled by a TikTok dance challenge, with the radio only picking it up after it had already become a nationwide phenomenon. This song is everywhere, on TV, all over the internet. I even found this YouTube video from a channel called Even Kids Can Draw that teaches your children how to draw their very own Walker Hayes beer cooler and all. Walker Hayes is our favorite country singer, and we couldn't use the song as background music, but you should listen to it as you draw this. Oh, yeah, for sure. Everyone knows that toddlers just love country rap songs about thrifty date nights with Victoria's Secret and Maybelline that ends with dipping your fries in your wife's Frosty.
She wanna dip me like them fries in her Frosty.
So, how did we get here? Why is this dorky, ugly-sounding, charmless dad joke of a song written by a man named Shane McAnally? Why is this the country song that hit it so big? Is it because Americans just love Applebee's that much? No, that's literally impossible. I mean, I know that America is the country that invented deep-fried Kool-Aid, but I still refuse to believe that anyone here has a sense of loyalty to Applebee's, home of the Strawberry Mary Swirl and the Irresistible. Honestly, in hindsight, I probably dodged a bullet the last time I went there.
Hi, welcome to Applebee's. May I take your order?
Oh, yes. I think I'd like to get the Bourbon Street Steak with the Oreo Shake, and if I could get some whipped cream on the top, too.
They kicked me out of Applebee's and said I'm banned from ever eating food again.
Damn it, food was one of my favorite things to eat!
Yeah, they still haven't lifted that ban. Presumably because I keep shit-talking them. Thanksgiving was a bitch to sit through. But anyways,
no, I'm convinced that people aren't actually dancing along with this because they vibe with it or they love Applebee's. It's all just rubbernecking. Walker Hayes said he made this song with no pretension and no desire to capture anything other than his family's actual humble, low-class lifestyle, but this song has so little dignity in both its lyrics and its sound that it comes across as more of an insulting parody than anything else. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's number 2 on this list primarily because it sounds like dog shit and has lines like these in it, but for God's sake, who the hell fantasizes about only being able to afford one milkshake?
Two straws, one check, girl, I got you.
Like, seriously, what is that? Why the hell would you put that in the song? I mean, my best guess is that it's supposed to be cute, like a Lady and the Tramp thing if the spaghetti had been waterboarded in barbecue sauce. But considering that you literally open the song by bragging about how low maintenance your girl is, it comes across like even on your big splurge night to Applebee's, you're too cheap to even buy your wife her own milkshake. This is supposed to be a song about living it up and having the best night you can within your means. So why the hell are you refusing to even imagine a scenario where you go even a little above and beyond for the woman you love?
You know, Patrick, this is a dream. You can do anything you want.
Yep.
It's some whipped cream on the top too.
Two straws, one check, girl, I got you.
And yes, I am aware that I stole that joke directly from Ethan, but don't worry, I actually paid him royalties for it this time.
Sean, that is not the payment we agreed on!
Bougie like Natty in the styrofoam.
Fancy Like goes beyond being the most embarrassing, shitty-sounding country trap song of the year by being an ode to complacency and stagnation that seems to have an active contempt for the lifestyle it claims to love so much. I can't believe I have to defend the song literally one spot higher on the list than this one, but at least Good Time actually gave lip service to the idea of finding happiness and satisfaction in the simple things in life.
Yeah, don't take much for us to have it all.
I mean, yeah, I want to punch him in the throat when he says it, but at least he's saying the right thing. That's what Fancy Like wants to be, but there's no sense of happiness or pride anywhere to be found. It just rattles off a bunch of white trash stereotypes gracelessly and artlessly with no connective tissue whatsoever. I can only assume this song got big mainly off a bunch of rich kids hopping on a trend and wearing this low-maintenance lifestyle like a Halloween costume. Fancy Like is a celebration of trashiness that sucks at celebrating, so in the end, you're left with nothing but the trash. It's one of the most cynical, clueless, and insufferable pieces of music to hit it big in years, and it's the crowning example of why 2021 was, in fact, a bad year for country music.
Alabama jammer, she my Dixieland alike. That's how we do, Fancy Like.
Alright, here we go. The home stretch. We've got a bunch of dishonorable mentions to talk about before we get to my pick for the worst hit song of 2021. But before we do that, I'd like to ask you to help me feed the unsatisfiable maw of the algorithm by leaving this video a like, subscribing and hitting the bell for notifications of every new upload, and leaving a comment about anything you want to talk about, whether it be this video, the music of 2021, or literally anything else. Every bit of interaction I get helps this channel grow, so thank you for that. And if you'd like to help me even further, then please consider supporting me on Patreon. You can see a list of my very competitive Patreon tier rewards on screen, and depending on what tier you join, you'll be able to have your name in the end credits, help decide what music I talk about next, join my Discord server, get early access to my videos, or even get your own personalized artwork scrolling across the top of the screen in every video I make. All patrons in every tier also have an equal chance to be selected to give a patron review in every video I make, and in this video, I've allowed my patrons to pick literally any song they disliked from 2021 to bash on record, so let's hear what they have to say. From Arison Bell regarding Permission to Dance by BTS.
Of all the baffling decisions that they made for Permission to Dance, the one that confused me the most is why they decided that they just weren't going to rap anymore, considering that that's their greatest strength and then, like, biggest draw for their entire career. All I have to say is I never want to listen to it again, and the Ed Sheeranification of BTS.
From Caleb regarding Way Too Sexy by Drake featuring Future and Young Thug. This is a very lazy song on Drake's part, as it's clear that Future and Young Thug are doing the heavy lifting with half-decent verses and lines, while Drake's lines are cringy. I'm giving this a strong 4 out of 10. From Richard Batchelor regarding Mama's House by Dustin Lynch.
Hello, Sean. Thank you for having me on here, and hello to everyone in the Diamondback Studio community. Hope you're doing okay. As we all gather to watch critics, though, rocked at the Applebee's commercial on year-end lists, I want to point out a song that may have fallen under the radar, Mama's House by Dustin Lynch. A hilariously terrible song where Dustin gets dumped and threatens to burn the entire town to the ground because of this, before saying, nah, just kidding. My mum lives here. So bad, it's almost good.
From Ryan Eister regarding The Good Ones by Gabby Barrett.
Honestly, The Good Ones is one of the most depressing songs I have heard all year. I know it wants to be this big, epic love ballad and all, but when you focus so much of the song just on how this one guy is to you, it is not believable in the slightest.
And last but not least, from Aspie Nomad regarding the music of 2021 on whole, this year's Billboard charts from an Australian perspective definitely look like a reflection of Biden's America. Fun fact, none of those Let's Go Brandon songs or that Chinese billionaire song ever charted on our ARIA charts. I would, however, like to apologize for Tones and I and the Kid Leroy. I promise, Aussie music used to be so much better than this. Thank you all for your continued support. You are the lifeblood of this channel, and I couldn't make this content without all of you. You can join for as little as $1 or $2 per video, literally just giving me a few quarters every time I upload. If even just half of you could do that, I'd be completely secure making these videos full-time, plus I'd also be able to afford going to grad school. So please consider supporting me, and thank you in advance. Y'all really are the best. That's enough shilling, though. Let's take a look at the second half of the dishonorable mentions, and then take a look at my pick for the single worst hit song of 2021.
Too sexy for this syrup, too sexy for your girl.
Did Drake manage to beat out Taylor Swift for the worst number one hit in the past 5 years that absolutely murders I'm Too Sexy? No, he didn't. But the mere fact that for a moment you thought I might say yes tells you everything you need to know about the quality of this song.
So there you go, oh, can't make a wife out of a hoe.
I'm putting the odds at a solid 65% that the kid Leroy is gonna wind up married to a proud hoe, and she's gonna give him shit for this song for the rest of his life.
But I've met one too many, come take me home.
It really is quite astonishing that each and every year, Pink somehow manages to find a new way to make my undying respect for her even more impossible to defend.
He's one of the good ones.
God, imagine I Hope by Charlie Puth being your artistic peak.
If I didn't love you, I'd be good by now.
I was originally gonna call this the fight song of country music, but then I realized that that wouldn't be a fair comparison because there is not one single line in this song that is anywhere near as interesting as I only have one match, but I can make an explosion. Trying to pass these off as lyrics is like trying to pass off a piece of loose leaf as an essay, and trying to listen to the full package as a breakup song is like trying to hydrate by drinking a cup full of steam.
I heard he shot, truck will make a big box.
No.
You brought me first. You brought me first.
Random 18-year-old girl who sounds like Camila Cabello doing a bad Billie Eilish impression getting a massive industry push for her emo breakup song was just about the single most predictable thing that possibly could have happened in 2021. I admit that I originally could not stand this one, mainly because of just how whiny it is. God, there were so many hits by immature kids this year. I've softened on it over time, I don't think it's god-awful anymore, but this is the worst kind of song for the radio to overplay. It's a song meant to be listened to in a very specific context, not forced on people when they're driving to work.
Small town boy in a big arcade.
I don't think I've ever listened to a song for the first time and instantly reached for a non-existent radio dial quicker than with this one.
I've got some famous friends you probably never heard of.
The song is actually perfectly fine, but these two artists should be banned from working with each other ever again purely because seeing the name Chris and the name Brown in such close proximity to each other makes me inconsolably angry. And speaking of.
You know that a nigga like me can change your life, oh babe.
This song is also perfectly fine, but as long as we keep giving Chris Brown hits, I'm gonna keep putting him on this list. The failure of the general public to kick Chris Brown out of the music scene is one of the most dire pop culture failings of the past 20 years. If you're gonna keep horribly abusive monsters around, please do the world a favor and at least pick the ones that aren't turgid and easily replaceable.
Need you to bring all of your friends and let's fuck it up.
Of course, it doesn't help that the radio still seems to love Chris Brown with all its heart. Seriously, literally nobody cared about this. Why the hell did it hit the Airplay Top 20? So this is why everyone hated Sunday Best so much.
And I will lie awake, making beautiful mistakes.
This was one of my last cuts from the list. I ultimately left it off because I can sit through this as a composition. It's definitely tolerable, but I'm sorry. I do not want to hear this guy bitching about having sex with this woman under any circumstances.
What if you had it all, but nobody to call? Maybe then you'd know me.
If you don't mind, I think I'm gonna take a second to read a few excerpts from the About page on Justin Bieber's YouTube channel, which you can go and read for yourself right now. An old soul is the last thing you would expect to find inside Justin Bieber, but all it takes is one listen to the young soul singing phenomenon to realize that he is light years ahead of his manufactured pop peers. I entered a local singing competition called Stratford Idol. The other people in the competition had been taking singing lessons and had vocal coaches. I wasn't taking it too seriously at the time. I would just sing around the house. I was only 12 and I got second place. As if Justin's natural singing talent wasn't enough to impress Scooter Braun's inner circle, he knew Bieber was also a self-taught musician who plays the drums, guitar, piano, and trumpet. His debut album, My World, is an intimate look into the mind of a budding young Renaissance man. With production from star hitmen, Justin has everything he needs to achieve pop supremacy. A virtually untapped well of natural artistic talent, Justin Bieber is primed to be a solid force in music for many years to come. There, there, Bieber. Everything's gonna be okay.
Lonely.
This is a weird position for me to be in, talking about this song on the top of this list. I alluded to this before, but over the years, the number one spot on my worst list has come to mean something, to me at least. Every year so far, when I've sat down to reflect on what piece of popular music truly bored, angered, or upset me the most, I ended up writing a long, winding entry about a song that not only failed as music, but came to represent something wrong with society on whole. Whether it be Logic selling out the suffering of depressed people, 6ix9ine holding up his sexual predator status as a trophy, or Ariana Grande making a rich kid anthem so insufferable that it made an entire generation hate capitalism, my least favorite song of all of the last few years have all had larger implications that really required a lot of nitty-gritty explanation and long-winded soul-searching for me to truly explain why I hated them so much. The worst hit song of this year has no deeper meaning. There's no greater theme behind my feelings on it. I don't have to go on any big, wordy tangents to explain why I can't stand it. All I have to say is that this was the worst thing to become popular in 2021, and nothing came particularly close to beating it. The time has finally come for us to end this once and for all, and all I have to say is that if you don't know what's about to happen, God, I wish I could see your face right now.
Three little birds sat on my window, and they told me I don't need to worry.
Yep, here we go.
Girl, put your records on.
It might seem a bit peculiar to say this, considering that this song is my pick for the worst hit of the year, above songs I genuinely can't stand, like Good Time and Fancy Like, but I don't hate Put Your Records On by Rit Momney. I'm just in awe of it. Every time I listen to it, I'm left utterly speechless, gobsmacked, reeling in sheer disbelief that a song like this was allowed to become popular, that people latched onto this, and that the industry gave this an environment to thrive. This is another song in the Trackstar category, starting out as a minor TikTok trend in late 2020, and then inexplicably getting picked up by the radio months later and turning into one of the biggest airplay hits of the year. Every single aspect of this song's rise has me at a loss for words, from the fact that anyone ever actively sought this out, to the fact that this is the TikTok trend the music industry decided to resurrect as a zombie months after it had died, and most of all, from where it came from.
Three little birds sat on my window.
It's pretty rare to see cover songs charting on the Hot 100 these days. Covers used to be a staple part of the American hit parade right up through the end of the 20th century, but they fell out of favor right around the same time that sampling started to become prevalent, and that does make perfect sense. Not only do you get your own songwriting credits when you sample, where you might not on a cover, but the creative license allowed by the interpretive nature of sampling gives you more freedom and flexibility than covers, all of which require at least some degree of consideration and respect for the original. And oh boy, this is an original that deserves to be respected.
Don't you hesitate.
Girl, put your records on. Tell me your favorite song.
Put Your Records On by British singer-songwriter Corinne Bailey-Rae was a worldwide radio hit in the mid-2000s, and it is absolutely sublime. It's just this incredibly sweet little bubble of folksy neo-soul sunshine, and it's absolutely impossible to be in a bad mood after hearing it, which is apparently why this dude thought it would be a good song to cover, you know, to lift everyone's spirits during the pandemic. Because really, who better to cover a beloved summer song by a British indie chick inspired by Lenny Kravitz than a guy who decided to call himself Rit Momney? And yeah, you heard me right. Rit Momney is just the one guy. It started as a band with a couple of his friends, but they left the project years ago so that they could, and I swear I am not making this up, become Mormon missionaries. So yeah, the name isn't a political statement or anything. The guy was literally raised as a Mormon in Salt Lake City. What the hell else was he supposed to name his band? And let me be clear that I have nothing against Mr. Jack Rutter personally. He's just a guy who had an idea for an experiment that he wanted to try, and I genuinely respect that. But the thing about experiments is that most of them end up failing, and on rare occasion, they fail so badly that the lab blows up, you inhale a bunch of dubious gas, and within the year, you've got a third arm growing out of your back. Which, yeah, that's the level we're on here.
Just more than I could take. Pity for pity's sake.
Rutter may have wanted to cover a cute little upbeat song from his childhood to raise people's spirits in hard times, but if you look for interviews with this guy, the very first line of the very first result reads, "If you're looking for an upbeat song for the summer, this isn't your guy," and that artistically, he has a real affinity for despair. Yeah, that checks out.
When you're gonna realize that you don't even have to try it any longer.
literally all of the original song's appeal is lost in this transition, and there is nothing salvageable here to replace it with. I mean, I'll give Rudder this, he is trying, he's really putting his soul into this performance, but aside from the vocal processing that sounds like a wave file of Joji being run through a washing machine, and the shitty, tinny, faux vibey broken music box production that makes me carsick, the worst thing about this song is that it's starkly joyless and tense. All throughout the song, Rudder keeps playing with the song's tempo, nearly letting it tail off into nothing over and over again, and it is horribly unnerving. It figures that the chorus was the only part I ever saw getting used for TikToks, because all throughout the rest of the song, he keeps starting and stopping the whole thing almost at random, creating a really unpleasant dangling tension that's the complete opposite of the carefree joy of the Corinne Bailey Rae original. This really does sound like an attempt to be uplifting from a man with a natural affinity for despair, which all comes to a head in the absolute nightmare of a final chorus. This part of the song begins just before the 3-minute mark, and I genuinely doubt that even one person who used this song on TikTok ever listen this far into it, because I am 100% convinced that the only reason it sounds like this is because Mormon Jesus is divinely punishing Rudder for leaving his church. This is the most horrific, soul-crushing, ungodly sound to come out of music in a long time. And keep in mind that this is the year where one of the biggest pop stars in the world literally gave Satan a lap dance. So yeah, purely on the way it sounds, this is easily the worst song to go mainstream in a long time. And you'd think that would be the start and end of my issues with it, considering that the lyrics are all the same as the original, and that song's lyrics were incredibly charming, and yet...
Don't you let those other boys fool you.
Okay, look, I know I said that I wasn't gonna bring any tedious moralizing into this, but I'm sorry, there is just something really icky about taking a line originally performed by a black woman meant to show solidarity and appreciation with black hairstyles, and using it as just an angle of approach for this pasty white dude to hit on you. At the end of the day, that recontextualization is what cinched this song the number one spot over Fancy Like. The original song is about a girl walking down the street, enjoying the sweet air of summer, letting her cares go, and hoping that everyone she sees is loving their life as much as she is. In this cover, instead of the girl telling herself to let her guard down, it's a guy telling a girl to let her guard down, presumably because he's aiming to follow his bandmate's footsteps and start his own missionary journey with her later that night.
Tell me your favorite song.
Maybe that wasn't Rudder's intention, I honestly wouldn't be surprised if it wasn't, but you know what? I'm sure Sam Hunt intended Take Your Time to be a heartfelt, passionate love song. There's nothing inherently wrong with a self-love song by a woman being covered by a man, nor is there anything inherently wrong with a white artist covering a black one. Of all people, I think Phil Collins proved both of those things pretty definitively. But when you take such a quaint, personal piece of self-affirmation and blindly copy it without considering what made it work in the first place, all while focusing more on sounding unique than sounding good, then at that point, you're basically just trying to copy a Bob Ross painting without following his instructions, throwing paint haphazardly onto a canvas and trying to blend your colors to create a beautiful sunset in your own unique way, only for all the colors to run together into a gross, indistinct, noxious smear of brown. Put Your Records On by Rit Momney, the worst hit song of 2021. I'm Sean Fay-Wolfe of Diamond X Studios. The best list will be out soon. Be sure to subscribe so you don't miss it. See you then.